All right, let's test the mic. Testing.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, guys, welcome. We are going to tell you about the question you have all been asking. How do we prepare for Angular 2? Because, I mean, they're giving us this great Angular 2 thing, but how do we get from 1 to 2 without dying in the middle?
My name is Michał Gołębiowski. I'm a member of jQuery and Angular teams, and I work in Poland in Laboratory ME. You can find me on Twitter and GitHub.
I'm Andrew. I work on the Onyx team, and I've contributed a lot to Angular material. You can find me on the same thing. All right, so Michał here says he's part of the Angular core team. So apparently, he's the one who's going to explain to me this mess that is Angular 1 to Angular 2 migration, because I haven't heard anything really good. I haven't seen any actual code samples of how I'm going to migrate. So what can I actually do, Michał?
So you can do something. You can prepare your code. You can structure your code in a way so that it will be way easier for you to migrate to Angular 2 in the future. First of all, welcome ES6. You can write ES6 code today. You will write Angular 2 code in TypeScript, probably. But you can, for now, we can use ES6 in Angular 1 code. It will be way easier for you to migrate.
You're saying I can, but ES6 is like completely different from ES5. I mean, how am I supposed to take my ES5 code and write it in ES6 without refactoring everything?
This is not actually that different.
Okay.
All the code that you're currently writing, that you've already written, is already ES6 because ES5 is a subset of ES6.
What?
You're already writing ES6 code.
Okay. I think he's a liar, guys. All right. Well, are you going to actually tell me how to do this then? Or are you just going to keep giving me lies?
I will.
Okay.
Okay, so
these Angular core contributors are so arrogant.
So, as I said, all your ES5 code is actually ES6, but you might want to use all these new features in ES6 that will make you easier to migrate in the future. So you can actually start today. Since all your ES5 code is valid ES6, you can just write all this code in ES6. But you need to transpile it somehow, because browsers don't support ES6 yet, right?
Obviously, yes.
But it's quite easy. Look, this is 5 lines of code, right?
Okay.
You just create a gulp task, use Babel, that's it. You can put it in your code, and it just works.
Okay,
already.
So you're saying this will take my existing ES5 project and transpile everything, which doesn't require anything, because it's already ES5.
Yeah.
And I can start adding ES6 slowly?
Yeah. Definitely.
Okay.
And
when
you need to refactor one part of your code, one view, because you're adding new functionality, changing some things, this is a great opportunity to migrate this specific view to Angular 2.
Okay.
So we can do this from by pieces.
Okay. What about when Angular 2 comes out and I want to like use part of it in my project?
Yeah, actually, this is you should just use the Angular 1 for router. The router that was built in previous versions of Angular is quite poor. But the Angular 1.4 router and the Angular 2 router have shared code base.
Okay.
They have the same code base. Directives are
right,
written differently, but
that.
Yeah.
The guy who's good at the internet over there.
Yeah.
That's my main compliment for him. You're welcome, Brian.
So if you didn't watch his talk, you should do it. And if you start using this router, then the good part of this is that you can switch pieces from by view. You can just switch a part of your application, then another part when you're ready. And then piece by piece, you're migrating all the code to Angular 2.
Okay, that sounds great. Okay, I've got ES6, I've got Angular 2, but what if I had like an actual ES5 service?
Mm-hmm.
This is a really common use case my clients have, especially my enterprise clients. Especially Wells Fargo, they really like this use case. They have a unicorn and they want to find it, you know?
Unicorns get lost all the time.
Especially at conferences. So yeah, we got this unicorn service. I use it in like all my apps. We got to find the unicorn. We get the location of the unicorn. We resolve a promise. We're using this weird ES5 style promise, which actually won't translate to ES6, like you said, because it's completely different from how ES6 promises work. So how would I actually translate this ES5 code to ES6? You say it's easy?
Well, yeah.
I doubt it.
It's quite easy, actually. Obviously, this code has a lot of problems. You have to use bind this because this binding is not propagated correctly. It doesn't look similar to what we have Angular 2. But let's do it side by side. So let's start with moving it to ES6, right? So first of all, instead of a function defining a service, you can just define a class. Instead of passing parameters to the constructor function, you can just create a constructor method. You inject your parameters there. You have to set them on this so that you can use them in methods, but that's all. Also, if you look at the findUnicorn method, then we've switched the syntax a little. First of all, we're using arrow functions. Arrow functions make your this scope lexical. This, awesome. This means you don't have to use bind this. It's okay. Gone. This naturally resolves to the this of your class.
Right.
So it's simpler. No boilerplate here. Also, if you look at $q, what we've done in it, since Angular 1.3, $q supports the constructor revealing pattern, which means it works exactly as the native ES6 promise. You still can write the code as you did before with $q defer, but you don't have to. You can use this syntax that's here. You just pass a function that takes resolve reject, and okay. It will be way easier to manage in the future.
This isn't that bad. We have ES6. Yeah. We have our Angular 1 service, but we still have to inject $q. We still got to return this $q. We can't use native promises because we're in Angular 1. I mean, I'm still not really happy with the solution. It seems like when I migrate to ES6, it's still going to be a lot of trouble. I mean, migrate to Angular 2 because I'm already in ES6. But yeah. When Angular 2 comes out, I'm still going to have a lot of trouble with this code.
So let's not speculate. Let's actually look how the service in Angular 2 would look like. So we have a different module system. We just use ES6 modules. So we need to import the class unicorn horn from the actual file defining a module. But we have a very similar class. We have a constructor that has the unicorn horn injected. We just need to specify that it's a type of the class horn, unicorn horn. We don't use $q because we have a native ES6 promise that just works fine with Angular 2. But now that we didn't have to change anything else because we just swapped this $q to a promise.
Okay.
And all the other code is the same. We still use template literals, we use the same code.
I mean, but we still had to change a bunch of stuff. I mean, taking my service from Angular 1 to Angular 2 wasn't that easy. I bet I changed at least half of this code here.
That's not true. But again, let's not speculate. Let's look at the diff. Yeah.
He prepared a diff. God.
This is a diff.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you're saying I only really added 3 lines of code for this service to go from Angular 1 to Angular 2.
Yeah. And if you look at the lines that changed, then Angular module is just a boilerplate. It will be very easy to change. And if you look at the constructor, we're obviously not injecting $q because we have a native promise, but it's easy to change.
Right.
We just change the syntax for annotations a little, for injection a little. But these are all cosmetic changes. You can very easily do it by yourself.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
I get it. Okay, a service is mostly business logic, so there's really not that much Angular in a service besides the dependency injection.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. But I bet you can't convert a directive from Angular 1 to Angular 2. You can't do that, Michał. All right.
Well,
because we all know Angular 1 directive API is disappearing on the slides for no reason.
Did it stop?
We got it. Maybe.
Did the server stop?
Did the server stop? Da 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 da.
Let's restart it. Oh man.
All is well. All is well.
Speaker next.
No problems. We just restarted the server.
I saw on the same screen. You have to
take We it migrated out. The server to Angular too.
Take it out of full screen.
Wait, where's
here. It's everything here.
He knows. See these core contributors are so arrogant. God. You know how hard it is doing a talk with this guy?
So this is
okay.
This is
okay.
It, right. Okay. These computers are terrible.
Okay.
You can't do a good
job. No, we got it. We got it. We got it. We got it.
Yeah.
Ha ha. All right. So we already went over this. I just wanted you guys to get a quick review, you know?
The directives crashed our server.
Yeah, Angular 1 directive API is so bad it crashed the server. All right. So yeah, I was saying he tried to get around this by crashing the server, but I was really trying to say, this is the Angular 1 Directive API.
Yeah.
I freaking hate it. It is so big and ugly. It's powerful once I learn it, but how do I even learn it? How would you even start to migrate one of these directives to Angular 2? It's impossible.
Well, yeah, I guess you have a lot of problems with this syntax, like one huge API defining all the things you can do with directives, and you have cryptic syntax like restrict A. What does it mean even?
Yeah, transclude.
Use compiler link or a lot of controller stuff. Yeah, so this is kind of a mess. But
this is from the docs, by the way. This is how bad it is.
But let's speak positively for a change.
Okay. No.
This is how Angular 2 directives look like.
Okay.
Way better, right?
Sure, yeah, we know Angular 2 rocks. News flash, Mr. Michał.
But let's look at this example so that we know what's happening here. So
okay.
Obviously we have a template. We define a custom element my-narwhal. It has a name attribute that is used in the bindings. So in Angular 2, if you read the code, it just says what it means. We use add component, so we know we're defining a component.
Right.
The selector says that we're using a tag my-narwhal. We have a bind property that defines the bindings. In this case, the name attribute value is bound to the name property of the component defining a directive. We also have add template. We can use a URL, but here so that it's easier to show, we just use inline. We have the same interpolation, and we have here six classes that define our
right.
API.
We have no more scope, cool. So we're right. Actually using the class instead of the scope, which is
and
great.
And this displays this
message. Yeah, that is what our precious narwhal directive will actually display, or component now. Excuse me. All right, so that's cool. Yeah, Angular 2 rocks, but look at this is my freaking Angular 1 directive. I mean,
yeah.
Directive, that's dead. Restrict is dead. Scope is dead. Link is dead. My business logic is dead. The only thing I can keep is my template. How do I even
template
start
is not
my
dead.
Cases?
Template is not dead.
This guy. Oh, my God. Okay. Yeah, but look, I can't even migrate any of this, dude. I mean, really.
Well, if you look at it this way, if you look at this specific example, it seems that, well, we have no choice. We're broken. Let's go home. Nothing's to do here.
Exactly. See?
But we have a way.
Isn't pessimism fun?
Well, if you told me that thing that you said that it's impossible to migrate it a year ago, I might have agreed with you. But we've had a couple of new interesting APIs that will make the transition easier for us. So let's look at one of them. We have to eliminate scope, right? We said that scope is dead. So
yeah.
We have to do something with it. We can't just use it and migrate easily. So let's eliminate the scope. So since Angular 1.3, we have the controller as syntax, which means that we give our controller a name. We can define our API in a controller instead of somewhere else, like in a link function. And we can use this controller in template, right? We just use a name, my-narwhal, dot, a method, big name in
sure.
this case. So all our methods are in the controller. We use controller in the template. Fine, right?
No, this is not fine. I mean, look, I still got my scope. I've still got my scope injected into my controller, and you can't tell me that works in Angular 2. And I've still got this controller as, I've still got boilerplate everywhere. I'm not enjoying this, Michał.
Well, you didn't let me finish, right?
He's such a tease.
There's only one API, but we have more. So another thing that is defined in new Angular, Angular 1.3 introduced bind to controller, which lets you bind the properties to the controller instead of scope. And in Angular 1.4, the syntax is even simpler, because you just use bind to controller and you define all your bindings there. You still have to define scope with these brackets because it needs to have a separate scope so that it works.
Sure, sure.
But this is the only place. In the template, you just use a controller. In the controller, you don't inject scope, right? If you did in the past example.
Okay, fine. Yeah, we don't have scope anymore. Everything's on the controller. But look at all this freaking boilerplate. I got to declare my scope, my restrict. I got to bind a controller. I got to declare my controller as. If you're telling me this is Angular 1 best practice, then I'm not part of best practice. This is way too much.
Yeah, I guess if you look at it, then we've made it a little easier to migrate in this way. But you always have to put restrict E, scope, which you don't use. So why would you
exactly.
put it, right? You have to name your controller. And like it's kind of natural to use just the same name. So why repeat it yourself? So yeah, there are a lot of boilerplate, and it's easy to forget about something. But what do you do if you have the same code repeated in many places? You abstract it. You create a helper, right?
Copy-paste. Every time.
I think I'll go with a helper.
He doesn't know.
So, how about this? How about if we had a component method on the module that would do it all for us? That would define restrict E, that would define the scope, that would define controller as to be the default name of our directive. We still could overwrite it,
okay.
but the defaults
okay.
would be sensible, right? And instead of bind to controller, we just use bind because this is the only way we would like
right,
to bind our
controller
things.
Is everything.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I'm a little happier with this because, I mean, we're in components just like Angular 2, same vocabulary. Scope is gone, restrict is gone, link is gone. I'm happy with that. All right, yeah, okay. But is this actually part of Angular yet?
Not yet, but you can see a link down the slide with the issue about creating this API. And there are some comments, there is a discussion how it will look like. And this exact proposal is put there.
Okay. Are there any core contributors in favor of this proposal?
Yeah, there are a lot of people that actually think this is pretty nice. It would make the migration to Angular 2 in the future easier, which is a noble goal.
Right. Yeah,
so,
for sure.
So, yeah.
Okay. Well, okay, we have ES5 though, but this still isn't really ES2 ready because it's not ES6 or TypeScript.
Yeah, but this is really simple to train. Like, look at that. Use an arrow function to just get rid of a function keyword. Use a class to define a controller. Right?
I guess, but I mean, this is still all in a function, and it's all different than Angular 2. How do I actually, this is not going to be easy to migrate.
Well, you don't really have.
It's still Angular 1.
You don't really have controllers in Angular 2, right? We've all seen this presentation from ng-Europe when jQuery is dead, scope is dead, controller is dead. So if controller is dead, then why creating a controller helps us migrate, right?
Right.
But turns out this is not all actually fully true. This is not that true that the controller is like completely gone. Michał once said that we love controllers so much that we made everything a controller.
Okay.
So you don't need a specific syntax, you don't need an API to create a controller if everything behaves like that. When we showed this example with a directive, instead of creating a controller for a directive, we just put all those methods directly on the directive. Why not? That's how it looks in Angular 2.
Right, right. So yeah, you're saying Angular 2, there's no such thing as this directive definition here. Everything is on the class. And we still have a class. Okay. Well, I mean, this still is, I bet you'd have to rewrite all of this to do Angular 2.
Actually, no. Let's look at the diff again.
This guy! So, oh my god!
So the diff is a little larger, but if you look at it, the class is what defines our business logic, right? So the class is completely unchanged. You have the same methods. And if you look at the lines that actually change, then these are pretty easy changes. Like, you need to change minor well camel case into a dashes. The bind syntax changed just a little, but it's just a little, right? There's a direct equivalent. And the template is pretty easy to migrate. So,
okay,
easy
peasy. I guess you show me that I could actually migrate a service and a directive to Angular 2 with little effort, especially if I start in ECMAScript 6, which is actually the new standard, and it's easy to integrate ECMAScript. ECMAScript, that's too hard to say, guys. ECMAScript 6 into my project, it's just one.
Also, note that in your application, you will usually have a lot more APIs. The class will be way bigger, so the code that will not change will actually be a much larger percentage.
I think it's so easy to migrate to Angular 2 that the universe is exploding.
Yeah. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.